Hello everyone. Today I'm going to talk about something which impacts every software developer, no matter which programming language, tools or framework you use. Yes, today I'm going to talk about a topic called black box debugging. So before we go ahead and do a deep dive, here is why you should consider black box debugging. If you have ever faced this scenario, like you got a bug in your production system and you are not able to find the root cause of it, what you do is that you patch the existing system with some additional logs and wait for the bug to reoccur again, with a belief that your additional logs can give you some indication of what might be the root cause. So if you are facing these kind of issues, you must consider black box debugging. So here is what black box debugging is. It's a totally different way of generating logs from the production system so that it's easy to find the root cause of a problem. Okay, so let's go ahead and understand what is BBD or black box debugging. Now, whenever we talk about black box debugging, something comes to our mind. This picture, right? Because black boxes are generally associated with airplanes. So, you know what? If something goes wrong in the airplane, can we say that, you know what? We will patch the system with additional logs and wait for a problem to reoccur so that we can find the root cause. If we even say that government will cancel the license, stock prices will go down, and the company may even have to file for bankruptcy. We cannot do that because it's a life and death situation, right? So let's talk about black box. It's a totally separate entity which is highly protected and capable of surviving very harsh conditions. It contains all the information required to ascertain what went wrong with the aircraft. And last but not the least, it doesn't contain information in the plain text format, which means that nobody can just pick up the black box and decode what went wrong with the system. It contains encoded information, and the ability to decode those information is there only in the specialized labs of the world, and there are very limited amount of those kind of labs. Remember this point, we will revisit this point. But before we go ahead, you might have guessed that what I am coming to, and you might have a question that why we need black box debugging in software. Now, you agree that with the airplane, it's a life and death scenario, but software today controls almost all aspects of our lives, from traffic lights to lifts to hospitals to medical equipment, everything. They are also capable of saving lives. So we have to make sure that we write software which actually performs its functions diligently. And if there is a bug, we need to find the root cause and fix it, not to patch it like increase the sleep timer or something like that. Those are dangerous fixes and catastrophic fixes. Okay, so let's go ahead and talk about black box architecture. So this is how black box architecture looks like. What happens that, you know, there is a totally separate entity which is connected to every component. There are thousands of components in a plane, and the functionality of a component is not dependent upon black box. So black box has nothing to do with the component functionality. It just stores information about what is going on in those components in it. So let's go back and see how we write code. It's a sample Python code. And you know what? Whenever we write any code, we generate lots of logs. Okay? Because when we are writing the code, we need to see how the system is performing. We write lots of logs. Over a period of time, we convert those logs to debug log, info log, and critical logs. So what happens that, first of all the logs are written in a disk or displayed in a console, and they are in plain text format because that is what we will understand, okay? But when we submit the code to the production system, at that point of time, we remove debug log and info logs. We just leave the critical logs, which we think are very critical for us to understand the system. Why? Because, you know, disk writes are costly. Okay? And that's one of the reasons we remove lots of logs from the production system. Otherwise, the performance of production system will go down drastically. Now, as I have already told you, BBD or black box debugging is all about writing the production logs in a totally different way. Now, what is that different way? What if I tell you that we can write logs, complete logs, whatever you wanted to get with info or debug logs in the production code, generate those logs without impacting the performance of the system. So it will be no worse than storing critical logs. Okay. I know you might be wondering that, is this even possible? I'll tell you it is. I'll let you know how. So now let's go ahead and understand how we can enable black box debugging in our code. First and foremost, we need to understand that all logs that are required for us to understand the system behavior must be present in the production code. Yes, I am right that everything that is required to understand the system behavior must be present in the production code. In the same way, all the information is present in the black box. Okay. For example, I have a sample system over here. So if I am in this particular state, the circle state, I should have all the information like how I came to this state, what is happening in there, and what makes me exit from this state. Similarly, for the next circle, how I came here, what I am doing there, and how I can get out of this. All those things should be there. Now, these kind of logging is only meant for understanding the system behavior, like how the system went from one state to another state, what were the events, what were the inputs, and what all major things have happened. It is not meant for writing the variable values or data structure values. Okay, those are not meant for black box debugging. It's only for system behavior, and it is meant for the fact that if we understand system behavior, we know at what point of time what happened, and the chances of us finding the root cause increases drastically. Now let's talk about enabling black box debugging in our code. First and foremost, the logs will not be written in plain text. We will write encoded logs. Don't worry, I will tell you how to create encoded logs. And even at some point of time, we need to dump the contents of a particular variable or data structure. Those also should be encoded, okay? And all the logs, just like black box, which is there at a totally separate place, the logs must be kept at a place which is totally separated from the production system, maybe a cluster database or cluster disk storage. Now let's see an example. I have written a very simple state machine code in Python. It is same in almost all object-oriented language. I have just written it in Python so that it's easy for everyone to understand, even if you do not understand the code. So basically, I have created an abstract base class called state and events. And I have a code for a state machine which starts with a particular state, and on receiving an event, this transition to function takes the state machine to next event. Okay, sorry, next state. Okay, and here is the example. Let's say I am in a happy state. Happy state is a state. I lost money. I am in a sad state. I gain money. I came back to happy state. And here is the code for this particular happy sad state. I have created two state, happy state and sad state. And I have created two event, lost money and gain money. And here is how my code looks like, you know. I'm just looping through happy state and sad state, generating event, lost money, gain money 100 times, okay, in here. So this is just a very simple code just to let you know that how we can get production logs for something like this that is happening. Now, as I talked about encoding of logs, here is how we can encode the logs. You need a mapping table. Mapping table means you need a table something like this. In here, I have said that happy state, sad state will be represented by 1 and 2. Gain money and lost money will be represented by Roman 1 and 2. Okay, that is my mapping table. Important point. The mapping table will not be with the production code. The mapping table will be with you, the people who write the code, the company who write the code, okay? And here is how we will write production logs. Whenever we write log, there is a log buffer. Some people create some circular buffer also. So you created your state machine, you are in happy state, just add one to log buffer. So it's us who know one means happy state, nobody else know. Then we get the event lost money, we move to different state, 1 to 2 state, Arrow means we moved from 1 to 2 state. We are currently in state 2, which is sad state. Again, event happened. Again, I have appended log buffer with state 2 to state 1. Now I am in state 1. Okay. So this is how you are going to add small amount of information. As of now, I am creating an integer, but depending upon the programming language, for example, C or C++, you can even use a single bit field to explain the states within the state machine. Okay, like first bit means happy state, second bit means sad state. So one byte of information can hold a lot of information. Now, here is how the log files will look like. It will be jumbled sequence of 1, 2 and some arrow, right? These are encoded logs and are of no use to anyone who even hacked the production system and looked into that, because they cannot make anything out of it, what it is, what it represents. They know it is doing something, but they will not be able to understand because they don't know how the code is written, right? But we can exactly regenerate what has happened to our running system because of the availability of our mapping table. We replace 1, 2 with our states. We will get to know what all states transition that has happened. And if we add Roman 1 or 2, we can also know what all events have been triggered. Okay. And yes, all these logs are production logs. So production system is logging all those things. Now, we will not just need mapping table. We need a set of infrastructure and set of codes to actually decode the information we are getting, the encoded information we are getting. We need some data structure, some storage format, mapping table, decoding logic, and visualization tool. So these infrastructure we need to create, it takes time. It is very similar to those specialized labs, the infrastructure they create to decode the black box information. So the input to whatever we have created is this encoded log. And once we get this encoded log and put into this particular infrastructure, this will decode what went into the system and how the state transition happened and at what state, what was the case, how system reached to this state, how it exited from this state. Do not underestimate the power of this information in a running production system. It gives you detailed information of what has happened in your system, what leads to a state where the problem might have happened. Okay, and then there is limited area where you can search to find the root cause. Now we know what is black box debugging. Let's see how in the software world we can collect encoded logs for black box debugging. So the biggest thing, the encoded logs must not be written in any local disk or local system where production code is running. No. So what you need to do is that, you know, you need to use a totally separate cluster or a server for storing these logs. And here is how. So for example, this is your production code running in multiple nodes. Even if we are running things on a single node, that's fine. The logic will still work. You need a totally dedicated server, totally separate server reachable via TCP. Okay. And if you do not have lots of money to spare, you can create a server for small space, small cluster, small disk space requirement, because you know what? You can rotate your logs for, let's say, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 1 hour, 2 hour, 10 hour, to the extent you can afford it. Most of the time, for most of the problems, whatever it happened to the system, something went wrong, data 10 minutes prior to the point when the problem has happened is extremely important. Okay, if you store data beyond 10 minutes, it's anyway good, but if there are some constraints with space, virtualization, virtual space, money, cloud space, anything, you can have it for a smaller duration. Okay, it is also very much useful. So every one of these will be connected to this particular server via TCP. So you put these encoded logs via TCP and you are just dumping it onto the server. This doesn't impact the performance of your production code, because you know what, TCP, you know, exchange can happen on its own. For example, you know, you can send a large buffer to the TCP stack and TCP stack will take care of it. It doesn't come under, once the buffer goes to TCP stack, the buffer or memory is no longer associated with your process. The CPU is no longer from your port process, okay? And TCP algorithm takes care of most of the things. Even if you want to direct small chunks, that is absolutely fine. What you need to do is that the dedicated server, there should be a cluster and a way of writing the logs so that you can decode it. So since you have written the decoding logic, you know how to write these logs. So let's talk about some of the ultimate benefits of black box debugging. Drastically reduced log size. So even if you are shipping your production logs from production system to your office, it doesn't take a lot of space. Gives you complete information about the system. As I said, can be rotated for last few minutes to hours. Depends upon our capability and availability of space and CPU. Okay. Now, you know, many a time, many developer will come and say that, you know, I want to know what is the value of this variable at this point of time, this variable at this point of time. It will not be a good idea to dump all those things into the this encoded logs. But if you are expecting some expected input, please do write an encoded mapping table and dump it. For example, you have created a UDP server and you are expecting some UDP packet. So you can have an encoded mapping table with the normal packet as one, abnormal packet, or whatever your criteria of abnormal and normal is, at zero and something like that. So you know what, to come up with a black box debugging, you need to work hard. You need to work to come up with all those things I have talked about: the data structure, the mapping table, the storage format, and the visualization tool, the decoding format, and the decoding logic. But if you do that, it's a win-win situation for you. And you know what, nowadays we should take software seriously, because as I said earlier, software does impact our life and software does save our life. It's very important for us to write software which is relatively bug-free, and to make it bug-free, we need to understand what is the problem, and to understand the problem, we need lots of information. Think of finding a bug as a job of a detective. More information you have at your hand, it will be better for you. So with this, that's all for today's video. That's all I wanted to talk about black box debugging. I hope you like the concept and you will definitely try it in your project, in your day-to-day work. Thanks a lot, people. Thanks for watching. Till the next time we meet, good day, goodbye, take care.